first international speaker of the day, Professor Woods. She's currently a professor at the Complex Carbohydrate Research Center in Athens, Georgia, and she came here from the United States of America. We're very happy to have you here. And his main areas of interest include carbohydrate antigenicity in immunological events, carbohydrate processing enzymes, and the development of appropriate simulation methods for these systems. Worth mentioning that Professor Woods, he was a professor of computational molecular sciences at NUI Galway for 6 years prior to his move to the United States. So he's here today to talk us about his recent developments regarding glycolipidics and their efforts to design inhibition and their efforts to inhibit influenza infection.
Thanks, everybody. I realize I'm the only thing standing between you and lunch. What I want to talk to you about today is flu and how to inhibit flu, and I'm still thinking of so many talks that are addressing what's called anti-adhesive strategies. This is an area that's particularly, it has very good potential for carbohydrate-based glycomimetics. So in influenza, as you see here, this little schematic, what it says is that when you get flu, it's evolved to recognize that the sugars on your cell surface. But all flu originates in avian species. And so it has to undergo some sort of mutational process in order for it to infect humans. And this can be, you can get direct infection by avian flu, but it's rare. You have to get really high exposure. More often than not, what happens is the flu has evolved to spontaneous or genetic reassortment with some other animals such as swine in order to develop human infectivity. Now, the process of infection, parts of it are better known than others, but this is basically what happens. Here in this little blob is the virus, and it floats around and eventually finds the sugars on your cell that it wants to interact with. Once that happens, then a rather mysterious process occurs where the membrane distorts and wraps around the virus and then pulls it in. This is called endocytosis. And we're going to come back to this a little bit later in the talk because it turns out to be quite relevant. Because in fact, what happens is for infection, it's not just essential to have binding, but you have to have binding followed by endocytosis. And you'll see why I emphasize that. Flu, the reason we care about it, as you've been reading here, is it kills a lot of people. It's so common, though, that we tend to accept it. You just don't think about it. Oh, yeah, somebody gets a flu infection. But really, a very serious disease. Now, in terms of the chemistry involved, what we see here is, regardless of whether you know the shapes of sugars or not, you can see that there are two different types of linkages. The one's called the 2,3 and the other's the 2,6. They have different properties. The 2,3 has a particular set of shapes associated with it, and the 2,6 has a particular set of shapes associated with it. And they're what differentiates the cells on the parts of the bird that are infected tend to have this sugar on, and the cells in our nasal parenchyma and upper respiratory tract tend to have this sort of sugar on it. Okay, so what the flu does is it grabs onto this sugar on your cell surface. Now structurally, this is a crystal structure of the head group of the protein on flu that's responsible for grabbing onto the sugars as it's being delivered. You can see it's a trimer as is shown schematically here, and there's three symmetrical positions that grab the sugar. And what's interesting is regardless of whether it's a 2,3 or a 2,6, that terminal sugar, the sialic acid, is in exactly the same place in all human ruminants. Okay, so the way it grabs the end sugar is the same, but there's something about the underlying structure of the 2,3 and the 2,6 that differentiates whether we get flu or not. So there's a few points to note. As you can see, sometimes flu is very serious. These are called pandemics. Sometimes flu is not very serious. It's seasonal flu. Pandemics tend to arise when a new flu strain is born out of a bird origin. And when that flu strain is highly pathogenic in birds, the fear is it can be highly pathogenic in humans. nervous whenever there's a new strain, the highly pathogenic avian influenza. It's not because they care about the death of chickens in particular. It's they worry about that strain crossing to humans. The other thing to note, and this became really obvious in the swine flu pandemic that happened in 2009, 10 years ago, it didn't kill all that many people, but it went around the world in, as I recall, about 18 days, something like that. So it really went around the world very quickly. Had it been more virulent, it would have been very, very serious. The problem with this is when we get a flu vaccine, the flu vaccine is based on what's known about currently circulating strains of flu and previously circulating strains of flu, but not, it can't be based on new things that haven't happened yet. So when a new thing comes up, there's a finite period required to make a vaccine. And what became obvious here is that there was no vaccine that was useful at the time. So there's motivation here for small molecule drugs to treat not just flu infections, but viral infections in general. So this is another picture of two flu viruses, and these are the hemagglutinins on two flu viruses. What you can see in green are sugars that are attached to the virus. So on top of the virus grabbing onto our sugars, the virus itself is covered in sugar. The virus uses these sugars to hide itself from our immune system, right? It's trying to evade the immune system. But it's variations in the positions of these glycans but also make vaccine generation difficult. So there's a number of features that weigh in here. All right, so what about small molecule drugs? You've heard of probably Tamiflu, perhaps, or maybe Relenza. These are small molecule drugs that block one aspect of the flu infection. In fact, it doesn't block the binding of the virus. The virus can get infected. What it blocks is the ability of the virus to be released from the infected cell. So what it's trying to do is buy your immune system time to fight off the infection. The problem is that, like all or many small molecule drugs, is they're susceptible to the development of resistance. And certainly, in the case of oseltamivir, a single point mutation in the target protein, neuraminidase, completely blocks the efficacy of this drug. So it doesn't mean they're not useful, but you need more than one thing. Always you need to be thinking ahead, what else can you be doing? And a completely underexplored pathway is the idea of targeting hemagglutinin, the protein that's involved in grabbing onto the cell in the first place. So here's the idea. Now, we just heard a little discussion about whether a dendrimer should be spherical or linear and all that, and that's based on the idea that the cell surface is kind of flat, and the target could lie on top of it, that sort of thing. And this is really something we have in our heads, but it isn't flat. It's a very complicated structure. It's hard to understand. It is that there's a bilayer. But there's stuff stuck into the bilayer, proteins, glycoproteins, glycosaminoglycans, like all kinds of things. It looks like this dwarf. So what the shape should be, who knows, and I agree totally with the, you got to try and see what it does. I'm a theoretician, theoretically you can predict things, but in reality that's a whole different thing. So anyway, here's the virus, here's the cell surface. What we're interested in is when it grabs onto this sugar, can we block this? And the reason we're interested in this is not, this isn't just something flu does. Many, many pathogens have the same initial aging mechanism. And that's because this sugar, this purple diamond, sialic acid, is common in so many glycans on our cell surfaces that many, many pathogens have evolved to recognize and grab onto it. So this includes everything from influenza through to Zika and some fairly scary viruses and so forth. So if we can get this to work for flu, not only is it important for flu, but the concept and indeed possibly the molecule may be useful on other pathogens. So the idea is to block it. The problem is, and we've heard this already, carbohydrates are not good drugs. They don't cross membranes, right? They're hydrophilic. They are hydrolyzable by hydrolases, with oxidation, like any A's you can imagine, right? So they're not stable. They're complicated to synthesize, and yet they're responsible fundamentally for the specificity of the interaction. So what we're thinking of doing, what other people are thinking of doing, is using the carbohydrate as the anchoring point to give the specificity for the drug, but then modifying it with drug-like moieties to make it more lipophilic, to give it other characteristics that you'd like. Now the problem when we started this blue project is what glycan do we want to give it? And it's a real problem because there's an innumerable list of them. And the idea that you're targeting 2,3 or 2,6 becomes pretty fuzzy because of a little bit of data. First of all, when you start looking at, does avian flu really only bind 2,3? Does human flu really only bind 2,6? The answer is unclear. It depends on what you look at. We wrote a review, it took 18 months to write the review. It shouldn't have been that long, but it was just trying to knit all this information together. Because it dates, you know, from ancient studies. They were bad, they're good studies. But it's studies based on red blood cell elimination that's used to define this 2,3,2,6 specificity. But more biophysical methods actually don't support that at all. And I'll show you some of the data. So what people have done lately being the last decade or so, is they've printed glycans onto glass slides. You can print maybe 600 or 700 leads onto a slide. And then put the pathogen on it, wash the pathogen off, and see which glycans it sticks to. This is glycan erase 3. It's a very high throughput method. Whereas previously with hemagglutination assay, you didn't know what it was binding, but you got a result. Here you know what it's binding. The problem is, do you know that the glycan you put on the slide is relevant? Is it just something you have in the fridge? Is it something a synthetic guy gave you? How do you know it's biologically? Well, but that turned out to be really a problem. So this is a 2,3 link glycan, and I showed it in the popular colors of glycobiology. You can see here's the sialic acid in the binding site, here's the chain sticking out, it would go on out and attach to some protein on the cell surface somewhere. Here's a 2,6. You see the sialic acid is in exactly the same place, but the chain is curled around different. And this has been known for a long time, and when it was first observed, somebody said, aha, this explains everything. It explains nothing. It's an observation. It's a great observation, but didn't explain a thing. Because when you look at the details of the interactions, they don't explain the specificity, but cannot explain how I can say that in a minute. But this was the paper. They said this one's cone-like, this one's umbrella-like, ta-da. And I was left completely wondering, well, how does this explain anything? And it's true that they have different chains, undeniably. But how does that result in the different specificities? And when you look at the data for these small sugars, these little trisaccharides, what you see, here's the binding energy for a 2,3 versus a 2,6, or a 2,3 versus a 2,6, 2,3 versus a 2,6. If you put error bars on that, those are pretty darn similar numbers. So this is why I say this dogma that 2,3 versus 2,6 barely holds up, if it does. But the biology is absolutely clear that 2,3 and 2,6 is important. The small molecule biophysics says, no, it isn't. And this is what was breaking my head for a long time trying to figure this out. But what it does suggest is that glycomimetic can either mimic this or this, and it should inhibit any of them, because they're all essentially the same. So whether you chose to mimic a 2,3 or a 2,6, it could inhibit avian or human or both flus. This was an interesting observation because some of the design work we did was much simpler, much more straightforward based on the 2-3 here than the 2-6. We went forward with the 2-3. That's what that says. Okay, so let's look at some interactions. And this is not terrible regular, it's just a schematic overview. But what we have here is a virus that has evolved. It's an AV virus. You should recognize 2-3 more than 2-6. And what I've shown the dashed lines are what a crystallographer would draw in terms of hydrogen bonds. And if I asked you which one would this prefer, most people would count dashed lines and then say it would prefer this. And yet it doesn't. Biologically, this is the substrate. So the good thing about this is that it agrees with the numbers from the biophysics that says really there's not much difference. The bad thing is it doesn't explain the biology. So there's a disconnect between what we're doing to study this in the lab, which is studying small oligosaccharides, and what's going on in nature, which is binding to big complex sugars. A small oligosaccharide, it turns out, is not a good model for a biological ligand. And that's, once you accept that, then all the data comes together. So here's how a glycan array works. Like I said, you put the glycans on the surface, and they'll be talking about this, I think, later today. You can wash on whatever you want, proteins, other small molecules, and you see where it sticks. Simple science. And this is what it looks like for flip. So here we see glycans along this axis, and these are 2-3s and these are 2-6s. And this is a species that should bind to 2-3. And this is a strain that should bind to 2-6. So, what if the right glycans are not on the array? How do you know? You don't know, because you don't know what the right ligands are. And this is fundamentally the problem. The conclusion from this early work is that this was basically grass. This was noise. You weren't seeing anything, because the right ligands weren't there. And the right ligands only became available when more sophisticated synthetic methods made them accessible. Things that used a combination of synthesis and enzymes, or two enzymatic synthesis. Now, as for simulation, we wanted to look at these structures computationally and see whether we could make any sense of it. And we did learn a few things. This is a simulation of, come on now, nice. This is supposed to simulation of a human type 2-6, that's why it's curled like this, like it's on the paper, bound to a human infected nucleus membrane, and it just sits there and wiggles, it does nothing exciting. But what that means is it's very stable, it likes this shape. Even though we all know a 2-6, well, you don't know, 2-6 linkages are very flexible, there's lots of shapes. We could adopt lots of shapes, but it doesn't, it sticks in this one. And this D225 is one of the key mutations that makes this human infective influenza strain. Now what we can do computationally, we said, let's just make one mutation. Let's convert this to a glycine, which is what you see in the avian influenza, and run a simulation. Started off exactly the same. And now it flops all over the place. And it isn't that the Aspartate you saw before did something favorable and stabilized. It just more or less pushed it into one shape. So what this is showing is that yes, they still bind, but in one case it's more dynamic than the other. And this has implications for entropy, and it has implications for what's called kinetics of binding, off-rate. This is going to come up finally in the next few slides. So now new glycan arrays come up. Now these glycans are pretty complicated things. These are much more like we see on our cell surfaces than the earlier arrays had access to. When you put these glycans on, what you see is that the shorter ones really don't bind to either 2-3s or 2-6s. But when you go to longer ones, you see how it flows. led into a whole different hypothesis about what's going on. Because we modern people. So here's this triangle of human remedies, rather than symmetric triangle in the slide. There's a spacing here between the binding sites of about 45 angstroms. In the biotinoid sugars, how long do the arms have to be before they span that space? It's a certain length, it's about 4 working units. And then they're longer. And at least they have the idea. I wonder if two could bind at once. Because that would give you a significant boost in the binding unit. And we asked the question this way. We said, well, let's put one side in the crystal structure, we'll anchor one side of this binary sugar, and then we'll allow the linkages to wobble, let them be flexible a little bit, and monitor this distance and see, is there any low energy shape that actually puts it in the other side? And this is what that looks like. Here it comes in. Bobble wiggles and linkages some more, and then we do what's called like the dynamic situation, which is just like relax a little bit, make sure we haven't bent it artificially into a shape. What this means is that when you have a 2-3 linkage on each end, if the branch is in long enough, then you grab both sides simultaneously. So now the question should be, well, what about 2-3s? Can they do it? Because if they can do it, then we haven't really been able to do it. And here's a 2-3. I put one end on one side, bring it around, but we couldn't get it to fit. And the reason we can't get it to fit is quite simple. See how this is oriented with the yellow, purple going this way? But it has to come in from the other direction. It has to hook around. The curving on the end of the 2-6 lets it do that. The 2-3s cannot do it. There's no shape combination that allows it to do this. So this is fundamentally what's different about 2-3s and 2-6s, is that 2-6s can form two binding sites at once, the 2-3s cannot. And now that curving shape makes sense. So now we come around to some experimental data that we use biophysics to measure these things. We've got some of these glycans, we've got PHAs, we did the binding experiment, and what you can see the binding here of what's called the on ring of one of these biotinoids binding to an avian fluid, HA. And then we let it dissociate, and you can see it coming off here. So it comes on and it comes off. And then we did the same thing, but now not with an avian, but with a human HA. And at first they looked pretty much the same. But look more closely at the off ring. They're really quite different. What this means is if you look at the KD, this one's 10 times stronger than this one, smaller and stronger. But it's all due to the difference in offering. This one's 10 times slower letting go. And that's consistent with the idea of this grabbing on from one hand. One hand can let go, but the other's still holding, and before this one lets go, this one grabs again. So it stays stuck. And you can see this here, it's just a bar chart of the same thing, and it shows that it's all about the off rate. And now we come back to endocytosis. Because they both bind, we saw lots of data, they both bind, but only one in fact. And what I hope to show you here, here's a cell surface, a flat membrane. It encounters a human virus, or it encounters an avian virus. It has to deform a little bit, it's got to grab on. But before it can fully form, the avian lets go, it's got a quick off rate. The human holds on longer and lets it wrap around and eventually endocytose. So they both form the initial binding, but only in a human can form the infection. And what I was looking at was the membrane, or somebody else's speaking, I apologize, was a little data to support this. And in fact, the formation of that clathrin-coated pit, the distortion of the movement, takes about 3 minutes. There's a
significant finite time required for this to occur. Okay, so now I think we understand avian and human infection and why we don't routinely get birds. And now we come full circle back to how we can make an inhibitor to block this. Because the dog in the field has been, you'll never block this kind of thing. Just look at all the interactions. You've got some nanomolar affinity. It's really, really tight. But it's only really, really tight after it's wrapped around. In the very first stage, you just have a single interaction. If you can block that single interaction, that's all we need. And so what we did was working with Paul Murphy's group. We did some design work and came up with a ligand that's based on the G3. So we figured if we would block the G6, because we already had the data to show it should anyway. And we put in this little ring, which does the job of making this two linkage system rigid. You know it's rigid from NMR, you know it's rigid. Dynamics. It also put it in the right shape for binding. Now, if you look more closely, you'll see it's a sealing glycoside, right? That's a carbon now instead of an oxygen. This has a lot of potential benefits. It's now no longer hydrolyzable. It's chemically stable. This gives us a framework that would be modified to make it higher affinity, but by virtue of the fact that it's rigid and in the right shape, remember we talked about entropy, this should bind more tightly than the natural sugar just because it's rigid. So here's the synthesis. It's a lovely piece of work that Paul can tell you about in detail. I'll point out the hard bit is obviously the sea glycoside formation. And Jen Handel did some very nice work on this marine iodide coupling here. This is the first structure of its type. And so if you've ever done anything, try to patent anything, some patents are really slow and tedious. This one was too much that. Just because it's just really unique. Does it work? Well, first of all, does it fit? Here's a co-crystal structure. This was done by Ian Wilson at Scripps, who's an expert on crystallography through Grinden. Our inhibitor is shown here in blue. And the native structure in green, they fit in exactly where they should. The sialic acid is precisely where it should. This bridging ring structure here is pointing away from the protein, so it's not hurting anything, and it's just holding everything nicely. Does it work? Well, here are IC50 curves where what we're looking at is blocking the binding of human lipid into natural sugars with our compound versus blocking with small oligosaccharides. And what you can see is we're about a tenfold better than the natural disaccharides. So just making it rigid. No new interactions, no new, nothing fancy in terms of new contact, but making it rigid gives a tenfold increase in affinity. Does it work in terms of infection? And this is where the rubber hits the road. So this is some work done in the vet school in Georgia. They took canine cells and infected them with virus in the presence of our compound or in the absence of our compound. And the green dots are infected cells. And you can see, yes, you can block infection. How much do you need? Well, that's what's shown here. So this is all the constraints of flu. We are everything from flu B. We've got avian, human, we've got a flu, H3, so all kinds of, they all bind sialic acid the same way, so of course it should inhibit everything. And it does. And the IC50 for infection is around about exactly the same number as here, which to me suggests that we're just blocking one binding event. Now this isn't good enough. Go forward with, depending on the therapeutic, I don't know how much you have to shovel into something to protect them against flu, but it is definitely proof of the capability of this framework to work. The steps we're doing now are what you would imagine would be next, which is making it into a better therapeutic based on the same. summary, glycan substructure is what's important for specificity. 2326 is there, yes, but the reason you get cross-reactivity and stuff, of course, they're both fine. It's just some fine better than others. It isn't on the array, you can't see it, so be careful when you're interpreting glycan array data. There are an estimate of anywhere from 10,000 to over a million different human glycans, and the biggest arrays have about 600. So yeah, be aware of this. So to wrap up, first of all, I want to thank Paul and the organizers for the opportunity to present this work, and all of this team has a very nice synthesis on this. Clark Tompkins in the vet school has done all the animal work on this, all the cell work, animal work will come. Crystallography, glycans, and then the people in my group and Paul's group who did the work. I'd like to thank you guys. Timescale we ran it for what you see is what we got. So with them being there's always the question, what if we ran it longer? But it seems that we've run many, many simulations like this. It seems fairly consistent.
My question, so.
I think it's my question. The signal is terrible normally, right? If you use about a 2 day of sugar, then you can attach it to, say, strep abdomen. Put the protein on the surface, and then you can find directly get a big signal. Yeah. So strep abdomen sugar complex binding to the protein. But you can do anything better than that, because that is not monomeric, and that data is hard to come with. You can take an antibiotic and fat,